Hi, this screencast covers the last two major tissue types in the human body, muscle tissue and nervous tissue. Muscle tissue in our bodies is of three types. The first is skeletal muscle, which gets its name from the fact that it is attached to our bones. When skeletal muscle contracts, it physically shortens and it pulls the bones that it is attached to closer together. Through this mechanism, skeletal muscle is responsible for all of the movements that our bodies are capable of. Skeletal muscle is the only type of muscle that is voluntary, which means that it is consciously controlled. In order for us to contract skeletal muscle, we have to plan the movement with our brains. We have to think about it. We become very good at this and may not really notice that this is what we are doing all of the time, but the contraction of this type of muscle is controlled by the brain, and there is active planning that goes into it. The second type of muscle, cardiac muscle, is found only in the heart. We don't have it anywhere else in our bodies. It has a physical structure that is very similar to skeletal muscle, and since form fits function, we can then predict that cardiac muscle contracts in a very similar way to skeletal muscle, which it does. Cardiac muscle cells shorten when they contract, just like skeletal muscle cells. And while this shortening doesn't cause the body itself to move, it does squeeze the blood contained within the heart and pump it throughout the body. Thankfully, cardiac muscle is not voluntary like skeletal muscle. It is involuntary, meaning it is not consciously controlled, and our brains don't have to plan out every single heartbeat. In fact, the heart can and will continue to beat even if its connection to the brain is completely severed, because the heart is capable of contracting without any action or planning on the part of the brain. The last type of muscle in the human body is smooth muscle. It is involuntary like cardiac muscle, so we don't and we can't plan its contraction. We find this particular type of muscle in our digestive tracts and also in the uterus of females. In both places, it is used to propel something through the body, either food or a baby, and it does this by putting pressure on the food or the baby contained within it while it's contracting or shortening its cells. You may be learning how to identify the different types of muscle tissue in lab. If you are not, you will learn how to do this later when we get to the musculoskeletal system. To make sure that we are all on the same page, I want to talk a little bit about the microscopic structure of each type of muscle tissue. If you were to put skeletal muscle tissue under a microscope, you would see something very similar to the picture here. Skeletal muscle cells are very different in their structure from other types of cells we've talked about in class so far. They are very long and cylindrical. If you look at the slide of skeletal muscle tissue that we've got here, you'll notice as you run your eyes across it that we have these cells that are very long and very cylindrical. What we're seeing with these white spaces in between are actually areas in between the cells. So you'll notice these cells are so long that they actually extend past the end of the slide in both directions. The other thing that's different about skeletal muscle cells is that they are multinucleate. So if you look at one of these individual cells, we've got one right here, there are several different nuclei that are actually associated with it. And that's true for all of the skeletal muscle cells that we have in this particular slide. The reason for this is skeletal muscle cells are formed from individual cells that fuse together. So you've got a whole bunch of individual cells with their nuclei fusing together to make a single cell that's very, very long. But because of that, it has multiple nuclei as well. There's one last thing that I want to mention that's unique about skeletal muscle, and that is if you run your eyes across the slide from left to right, you'll notice that the cells have a banded pattern. So we've got basically areas of light pink that alternate with areas of dark pink all the way across the cell. It gives the cell kind of a stripe pattern, and the striping is what's known as striation. So we can also say that skeletal muscle cells are striated. When we get into the musculoskeletal system, we'll talk a little bit more about the proteins on a microscopic level that cause skeletal muscle to have this striped appearance to it. Cardiac muscle shares some similarities with skeletal muscle. If you look at our slide of cardiac muscle here, and you run your eyes from left to right across the slide, you'll notice that cardiac muscle is also striated. It has that striped or banded appearance to it. However, cardiac muscle cells are not long and skinny like skeletal muscle cells. They are shorter and they branch, meaning that they are typically V-shaped or sometimes Y-shaped. Another big difference is that cardiac muscle cells are not multinucleate. Each cell has only a single nucleus. Despite these differences, because of the striations, skeletal muscle and cardiac muscle can appear similar under a microscope. To be able to tell them apart, I look for what are known as intercalated discs. These structures are present with cardiac muscle, but not with skeletal muscle. They are specialized junctions between cardiac muscle cells, and they run perpendicular to the striations. Several of them can be seen in the slide here, and I've circled a few to make sure everyone is focused on the right structures. When you see these intercalated discs, you know that you're looking at cardiac muscle. They can sometimes be faint on slides in the lab, so if you're trying to find them and struggling, be sure to let your lab instructor know. The last type of muscle tissue, smooth muscle, gets its name from the fact that it is not striated like cardiac muscle or skeletal muscle. Because of that, it has a smoother appearance. The cells are shaped differently from what we see with cardiac muscle or skeletal muscle as well. Smooth muscle cells are spindle-shaped, meaning that they are tapered at their ends. While it isn't often easy to see the spindle shape of the cells under a microscope, the nuclei of the cells, which are elongated horizontally, are usually quite visible. That, along with the fact that there are no striations present, makes this type of muscle tissue relatively easy to distinguish from the other two. The last major tissue type in the human body is nervous tissue. We'll get to this tissue in much more detail when we enter the nervous system. For now, you should know that this is the type of tissue found in the brain, the spinal cord, and the nerves that run throughout your body. There are two basic cell types in this particular tissue. The first are neurons, and you can see them here on this slide as the large dark staining cells with long extensions coming off of their cell bodies. These cells are capable of creating and then transmitting electrical signals, or what are also known as nerve impulses, down their extensions. And this is how different parts of the body communicate electrically through this cell type. The other type of cell that is present in nervous tissue are neuroglial cells. They play a supporting and protecting role in the nervous system, ensuring that the neurons have what they need to function optimally. If you look at this slide outside of the neurons, you'll notice dark staining circular flecks. These are the nuclei of the neuroglial cells, and we'll talk about them quite a bit more when we get to the nervous system. This concludes the screencast on muscle and nervous tissues.